just can't get enough and you want to watch this again, or if you want to tell your friends about this this presentation. I also want to thank some of our sponsors. Blue Mountain Arts has been sponsoring the Colorado Shakespeare Festival for 20 years. They continue to support us every year. We're so grateful to them. I also want to thank Liner Law, White Wave Foods, and Haynes Food. And those are three organizations that have decided to become the educational sponsors. So they are businesses that support CSF, but specifically support the educational programs, and they allow us to have events like this, which is very cool. We're going to have a little talk tonight. We're going to do some Q&A afterwards, and then we'll have a drawing for tickets to opening night of February 5th. If you haven't signed up for the free drawing, you can sort of sneak out the back and sign up now and get your name in there. And I think that's all I have to announce. Be sure to see the other productions in the summer season. We're also running Much Ado About Nothing on the outdoor stage, which is already opened, Othello, which is already opened, and are you entering the drawing?
No!
I'm going to do that to see if the, so the screen doesn't have a glare on it.
Great. Edward III, at the very top of our genealogy there, he was known as a warrior king, the height of chivalry and of knighthood and things like that. He was the one who went to France and starts off the Hundred Years' War and says, "I'm king of France. My mother was queen of France, therefore I'm king of France." End of story. He conquers most of France and pretty much just tells them he's the king. Richard II, when he becomes king, doesn't care as much about being Can you remember? Bolingbroke, exactly. Bolingbroke. His picture, somewhere up here. There he is, Bolingbroke. Way over here, underneath John Gaunt. Yes, John Gaunt is the third son of Edward III. This is also part of the problem in this magnum opus, is that Edward III has lots of sons. Bolingbroke proposes Richard II. He spends about 14 years on the throne. This is a time that is not necessarily peaceful. We get all of what happens in Henry IV Parts 1 and 2. We have the Battle of Shrewsbury, the rebellion of the Percys trying to put the Mortimers, who we also see on this genealogy, descended from the Duke of Clarence, onto the throne. We also get the traitors that show up in Henry IV Part 2. Meanwhile, the Scots are kind of fighting people, the Welsh are, you know, uprising. It's not a settled reign. Henry IV kind of ends his reign very distraught, trying very hard to hold on to this throne and to this crown that he's not entirely sure from the beginning he had the right to in the first place. Okay? And a very interesting fact for what comes in Henry V, the French king, Charles VI, never recognized Henry IV formally as King of England. He refused to acknowledge it. He said, no, you're not King Richard II. I don't know who you are. Yeah. Henry IV, of course, begets Henry V, King Henry V, and we finally arrive at our play. Henry V becomes king in 1413. He's about 25 years old when he becomes king. He had started to take power toward the end of Henry IV's reign. Henry IV had these bouts of madness, of illness, that nobody's entirely sure what they were, and in that power vacuum, Hal starts to take over some power, starts to consolidate power, and his father dies, sorry. When his father dies, he steps into his role as king fairly easily. The first thing he decides to do is say, I'm getting France back. That's going to be my job. I'm going to get France back. This is a very tactical move on his part. He knows exactly what he's doing with this. We'll talk about France a lot in minutes. But just to get back to our genealogy, just to finish this off, Henry V begets Henry VI, who of course is king at the start of the next play, Henry VI Part 1, which is really an extenuation of the Hundred Years' War. That's when we get the War with Joan of Arc. We get the very beginning of the Wars of the Roses. And the Wars of the Roses we see also happening on this genealogy, descending over here from the Yorks. Yes, all of these folks, the Mortimers get in there a little bit over there, and the Lancastrian kings descending from John of Gaunt. That's the Wars of the Roses. It goes all the way back out to Edward III. That's how far back the genealogy goes, how the war goes. And then you can see this genealogy goes all the way down. We get Henry VII, who's descended from Henry V's wife in her second marriage, Elizabeth of York. We get Henry VIII, we get Queen Mary, we get Queen Elizabeth. There's the English monarchy. All on the side. Getting back to Henry V, though. Here's a little picture of Henry for you, just so you can have a reference. So Henry decides, he becomes king, and he decides he's going to take back France. One of the first things he does in his reign, which I find very fascinating, is he reburies Richard II's body. Richard II, you may remember, had died in prison, jailed by Bolingbroke. And there's lots of different rumors about how exactly he died. He died in prison, and he was buried at King's Langley, which is not what he wanted. And if you remember anything about Richard II, you remember he liked his pomp and circumstance. He liked things done with ceremony. He liked things done the way he wanted it done. So Henry V becomes king and reburies Richard the way he wanted to be buried in the first place, at Westminster Palace, Westminster Abbey, yes? This has the effect of two different things. It means that he has atoned, in a way, for his father's actions, that he has put Richard in a final resting place according to his wishes. It also means that he parades Richard's body through the countryside, and everybody who in previous years had said, Richard II is still alive, could no longer say so. Because there's his dead body past you, yes? So that's one of the first things he does as king. Then he decides, I'm going to go after France. He goes to the French and says, look at my genealogy. I am the French king. This is clear as day, is what is said in our play, actually, a very hilarious moment. He even goes so far as to cross his banner of the Lion's Rampant with the fleur-de-lis, the French banner. this is a very cocky move, kind of just saying, well, that's your banner, so I'm just going to put it on my banner and prove that I am the king by doing so. Yeah, the French don't like this. The French do not like this whatsoever. There had been a prophecy that Henry of Monmouth would win France back, and Henry of Windsor would lose France. So we see Henry kind of taking this on. This is going to be his legacy, getting France back. This move has a wonderful effect on his reign. It means that anybody who would have dissented against him is distracted by the prospect of getting France. It's going to be amazing. It's going to be wonderful. They get so busy trying to prepare to fight this war against France that they forget to question his legitimacy. They forget to argue with him. Even Parliament, notoriously with Henry IV, refused to give him money, would not give him enough money to fight his Welsh wars. Parliament gives Henry all kinds of money in unprecedented moves, giving him a taxation for life on, what was the bull coming into the kingdom? Henry got a taxation for life on that, which was unprecedented. No king had ever received that kind of money from Parliament before. So the entire country unites behind Henry and says, yes, we're going to France. August 1st, 1415, everybody meets in Southampton. Southampton's on the southern border of England. Here we go, Southampton, you can see it up there. August 1st is the day that everybody is set to muster at Southampton with all their men. They get ready to sail. They end up sailing a little bit late because this is where we discover the traitors. If you're running into the 5th, you know about the traitors scene. I'll just say briefly about them. Shakespeare has the traitors taking money from the French in order to kill Henry V. That is a collaboration between the English and the French. In actuality, this was a continuation of trying to put the Mortimers back on the throne. This is the continuation of what happened with Richard II, in Henry IV, Part 1, yes? Where they decided that the Mortimers were descended from the second brother of the second son of Edward III, and therefore had a better right to the throne than Henry IV and Henry V were descended from the third brother. They get their attention. Yes? Everybody gathers in Southampton, they discover the plot, they set sail a couple days late, 25,000 men, they say, go with them, and twice as many horses, every man had to have a horse. They've been building ships for 2 years, they end up having to send up to London for more ships, they have to ask all the fishermen at Southampton to take their ships over as well, because they don't have enough ships for the number of horses and men and supplies that they are taking with them to France. And even so, men get left behind. They still don't have enough places to put all the men. Some of the ships have to come back to Southampton and get them to come back to Harford with them. Yeah. One of the best signs that happens, and we can see it on this banner, you can see that swan there on the banner. That was Henry V's personal badge, the swan. It was he got it from his mother, who got it from her mother, and it had been in his family for a long time. And as they're setting sail, as the ships are all moving out, two swans go gliding through the fleet, and they take it as a sign from God that their mission is blessed, and that he's on their side, they're coming with France. Yeah. They arrive at Harfleur. This is something, so you can see Harfleur there on the coastline. The French did not know where the English were going to land. It was quite a struggle for them. They had messengers kind of lined up along the coast waiting to spot the English fleet so they could prepare whatever defense they needed to. They still don't figure out where the English are going to land. The English land at Harfleur, a coastal town there, and they begin a siege of Harfleur. Typically, in this era, sieges are supposed to last about 2 weeks. You pummel the walls with catapults, you attack the walls a couple times, get oil poured on you, and eventually you break the town. This siege lasted, as you can tell from the dates there, quite a bit longer, almost 6 weeks. So it takes Henry a very long time. Part of this is that the French have Raoul Sire de Goncourt. He is charged with the defense of Harfleur, and he does a fantastic job. They open up a dam and flood the area around Harfleur, creating a moat, making it very difficult for the English to communicate with one another. Henry has to have half his troops on one side and half his troops on the other, commanded by his brother, Thomas Duke of Clarence. They're trying to tunnel under walls, they're trying to get around this moat, they're trying to do all this stuff, and meanwhile, they all have dysentery. this happens. So they're all getting sick, they're all getting tired. 6 weeks go by. Finally, the French and Harfleur realize we don't have any backup coming. They, all this time, they've been holding out, thinking that the prince or the king or somebody was going to send them help, the Duke of Orléans, anybody. They realize that nothing's coming. They call a truce. They talk to Harry. They say, Henry, please, let us just send a messenger and if it, to the Dauphin. And if no help is coming, then we surrender. And Henry actually says, sure. They call a three-day truce. A messenger goes running out and comes back and says, yeah, sorry. Sorry. So the town surrenders to Henry. The French essentially sacrificed Harfleur. They said, we're not going to bother. Henry can take that one. We're gonna hold ourselves in reserve. And eventually we'll get around to smacking some of the white folks. The French don't take Henry seriously at all. They do not think he's a real threat. Henry receives the keys to Harfleur. He has the governor of the town come out in his underclothes, barefoot, bareheaded, walking through all of Henry's troops to the top of the hill where he has to debase himself and hand over the keys to the town. Henry then leaves a small garrison in Harfleur. They spend a couple days there, you know, getting themselves back to order, and then he says, I have to keep going. I'm not done yet. Originally, he had intended to go marching all through France and to conquer a whole bunch more. But it's now October. October in France, in northern France. It's getting colder, the weather's changing, the campaigning season is ending. He's lost about a third of his troops to dysentery at this point. A bunch of his men have to be sent home to England, plus he has to leave troops in Harfleur. He cannot do what he originally intended. But he can't also just leave Harfleur. He can't just go back to England. What has he proved if that's all he does? So instead, Henry decides, I know, I'm going to march to Calais. Because the English have Calais, I can go marching across the countryside, and it's going to prove that I can do it. He's just kind of trying to thumb his nose at the French and say, I can do whatever I need to. You know, your country is no stop. I know your countryside, basically. So he gathers his men, he says, everybody pack just enough food for 8 days. This is going to be a grueling march. We are going to make a direct line to Calais, and then we're going to set sail for home. They get going. And as you can see, they kind of start along this red line, they follow along the coastline. They get to the River Somme, and by the time they get to the River Somme, the French army has finally roused itself, and the French army is waiting on the other side of the river. So they can't cross the river. Yeah? They start this kind of chase where the English army travels along the Somme here, and the French army is pacing with them, dogging them along the entire way. Every bridge they come to, the French army is already there. They can't quite find a way across the river. Until they reach that point, kind of all the northern side, you just see it there, above Meslay, where the river curves around like this, and the French army has to go all the way around, and the English army dashes straight across as fast as they can. And they get to two bridges, which are in a terrible state of disrepair, and as fast as they can, fix those bridges, and they start to cross. They finally get across the Somme. In the middle of their crossing, the French army finally catches up, and amazingly, sits there and watches. They don't do anything. They don't attack. They just sit there and watch the English army cross. And then they go away. It's one of those moments where you kind of go, what were you thinking, friends? Really? The English army crosses. They have been on the road now for 16 days. Do you guys remember how many days I told you Henry had packed food for?
Eight.
They are running out of supplies. It has been raining. They're cold. They have no food, they have no clean water. They tried to get some from towns along the way, but they haven't gotten enough to really keep going. A bunch of them still have dysentery, just happens. Henry calls a halt for a day, asks them, get everybody take a breath, it's okay, we're almost there. We're gonna make it now, because we're on the other side of the river. They keep marching, and as they keep marching on October 24th, they come over a hill, and there they are at Agincourt. And the French army is waiting on the opposite side of the field. It's late in the day, so they all kind of start to get ready to fight, and they go, it's too late in the day, and they all make it. They decide to just go sleep instead. Throughout the night, the French are drinking, they're playing games, they're carousing, they're having a grand old time of it. The English, meanwhile, are sitting there cold and wet and hungry with no alcohol. And Henry orders them to have no fighters, too. He says, we're not even going to light fires, you guys just sit. It's kind of a miserable night. Dawn breaks, And finally, the sun comes out, fortunately. In a sense, fortunately, I guess. And everybody forms up into their battle formations. And I love this. We have so much information about magical words. It's amazing. So you can see here, we've got the English camp down here, the French camp on the other side. We've got the town of Agincourt, the town of Trincourt, and the town of Maisoncelles. I don't speak French, so I apologize if I'm butchering those names. The English all form up right about here. The French are all formed up on the other side of the Equatorial Hill. The English, of course, have a lot of longbowmen, which you can kind of see are scattered throughout and positioned also into the woods. So Henry really has a great spread of soldiers. And of course, at Agincourt, everybody talks about the difference in the size of the armies, like the odds were something anywhere between 2-1, 2 Frenchmen to every 1 Englishman, to 6-1, or 10-1, 10 Frenchmen to a single Englishman. Everybody has their own way of determining those numbers. We don't know for sure how many people were on either side, but we do know it was uneven. The French army really thought that they were going to win. There was no way that they could lose this battle. We stand like this for 3 hours, staring at each other across the field. Nothing happens. Henry orders his troops to move forward to that second English position. And that second English position brings them in longbow range, not crossbow range. Yeah, crossbow range, crossbows are the ones that you shoot like this. Longbows are traditional English longbows, which I'll get to. In order to do this, his archers all have to pull up these massive double-pointed stakes from the ground. They hike forward through this muddy, deeply plowed field. They hammer their stakes back into the ground, and then they set up again. The French, again, watch. Once more, they do not attack. They do nothing. They simply let the English move forward. Once the English have reestablished the second position, the French cavalry finally starts to charge. And this is where I think it gets really, really fun. I shouldn't say that about battle, but I think it's really interesting. So everybody knows that what's the main weapon that wins Agincourt for the English? The longbow, the English longbow. The English longbow was about 6 feet tall, made of Italian yew. The center of it would have been made from the hardwood of the yew, and then the outer part was from the outer wood, and preferably all carved from a single tree. Yeah. The English longbow, you had to draw it all the way back to your ear. Most bows you only draw in your mouth, so you can sight down the arrow. The English longbow was drawn all the way back to your ear. So you couldn't really aim it. You had to have a sense of where you were aiming it. And it took 150 pounds of draw to hold it here. Think about that for a minute. 150 pounds to hold a longbow like that. These archers were raised from young ages. England had archery competitions across the country so that every male from the age of 11 up would participate in an archery competition every Sunday afternoon in their village. And that's how they raised this English longbow army. We have stories of a shipwreck being found in Henry VIII's time with the dead bodies of these archers, and their musculature and their spines are deformed from the strength it took to be able to draw these arrows and shoot them, which I think is just every archer in Henry's army had to be able to shoot at least 10 arrows a minute. So it's an arrow every 6 seconds at minimum. Many of them could shoot faster, could shoot every 4 seconds. Yeah? And all these archers had two bundles of 24 arrows. Most of them, they put the arrows right in the ground at their feet so they could just draw and keep shooting over and over again. Yeah? So you have, some say as many as 5,000 archers, each with 48 arrows, shooting at about 10 arrows a minute. That's 5 minutes of 5,000 arrows every 5 seconds coming at you. This is what the French army decides to charge into. They start charging and the English just start firing. You can imagine the chaos that would ensue from something like this, right? Kind of get the idea. These arrows can pierce armor, they can kill horses. The chaos in the field happens. On top of that also, it's still muddy, and the French can't actually move that fast across the field. They can't go charging the way they really want to. The chaos is immediate. It's insane. The English hold their line, largely because the French have so many more people that the people at the front of the French line are being crushed by the people at the end of, at the back of the French line, who want to get up to front and want to figure out what's happening. The English just stand there and keep poking, keep killing people, until these bodies start piling up. There are stories of Frenchmen clawing over their dead bodies of their country they're trying to get at the English, who just stand there and wait for them to come at them. That's all they do. This goes on for about 3 hours. 3 hours of fighting like this. The Earl of Suffolk dies, the Duke of York dies, and a few other people fail. The Frenchmen all had this competition to see who could get Henry's crown first. There's a massive attack to go and do that. They manage to cut off a piece of Henry's crown before they're cut down. There's some great stories from this battle of the heroics done. At the end of the 3 hours, Henry finds out that the luggage train, which had been back here at the English camp, has been attacked. It was attacked by, and he doesn't know this, but it was attacked by men from Agincourt and Trainecourt, civilians, villagers, who were just trying to get some share of some spoils of war. They actually ended up making off with Henry's second crown, things like that. It takes them the English months to get back. That's hilarious. So he finds out that he's been fighting for 3 hours. There's dead Frenchmen everywhere. There is still a third reserve of Frenchmen at the top of the hill. They have not yet entered the battle. It's at this point that Henry orders the killing of the prisoners, which is a very controversial decision. He had also ordered at the beginning of the battle that no Englishman would take any prisoners. He knew that he did not have the men to guard prisoners in this fight. He needed every man fighting. And so as the fight goes on, as the English are winning, Henry starts to, they start taking their own prisoners. All the English start taking prisoners because that's when your spoil is for. Henry realizes he's lost men to that. Those prisoners at any moment could change sides again, could pick up a weapon and start fighting again. His luggage train has been attacked, and there is still a third French guard in the rear that have not yet attacked. This is when he orders the killing of the prisoners. Right or wrong, I don't judge. I cannot imagine being in Henry's shoes at that point, having been on a march for 18 days, 8 days of food, tired, exhausted. The knowledge you have, I cannot imagine what it must like to be in his shoes. But I think there's a lot of reasons for him doing what he did. At this point, the French herald, Blaisois, he's the senior French herald, he comes down, he talks to Henry. The heralds, both English and French, had been standing up on a hill watching the entire battle unfold. That was their job, was to watch this battle unfold and to write down all the feats that had been done, to write down the dead, etc. Henry goes to Blaisois and says, "What? Yeah, you need to have a verdict." And Blaisois says, "The day is yours." And Henry immediately falls to his knees and thanks God for the victory. Fast forward 3 years. Shakespeare conflates 3 years into a prologue, which is amazing. Essentially, in those 3 years, Henry goes back to England, then comes back to France, conquers. Conquers the northern part of Normandy, as well as Rouen and Paris. You can see some of the longbowmen there. You can see the up there at the top, you can see the combination of Henry's banner with the fleur-de-lis, the lion's rampant with the fleur-de-lis, and some of the battle that I was talking about, which is the general chaos of the battle. He conquers a whole bunch more of France until finally the French agree to stop the fighting, stop the madness. And we have the Treaty of Troyes in 1420. So this is 5 years after Agincourt, we finally get the Treaty of Troyes. And the Treaty of Troyes says that Henry V is now the heir to Charles VI, who is the King of France. It does not immediately make Henry king. It says that he will be king upon Charles VI's death. It also is the treaty that leads to Henry's marriage with Catherine. Catherine was the daughter to Charles VI, and so in her marriage with Henry, essentially, the treaty says that any heirs produced by Henry and Catherine will then be the heir apparent to France, which disinherits the rest of the French family, the Dauphin and all of his brothers. This is what then sets us up for what happens in Henry VI, part one. Henry and Catherine are married in Troyes, which is the seat of French monarchical authority at this point in time. 1 month later, she's pregnant. Before she is able to give birth, Henry is back in France, trying to keep everything good. VI dies a month later, which then immediately puts a 9-month-old King Henry VI of England onto the throne of both countries. And that's what sets us up for the next one. So there you go. There's your history lesson for the day. That's a lot of the stuff that I've been kind of contributing to rehearsals, trying to help our actors understand, well, why do I talk this way? Or why am I worried about this thing? That's a lot of what I've been talking about. Yeah, it's that. And I'm going to turn it over to Carolyn now to talk a little bit more about her vision and this direction.
I have to say, Hadley is invaluable in these rehearsals. And I've worked with her last summer on Andy before, and she knows this history so well. And it's such a luxury to work with a dramaturg of her caliber and quality, because essentially I don't have to know anything. And I can just say, happy. And she, it's wonderful. So thank you for
all your brain. It's good.
So, what do you think a director does?
Directs.
Besides be really bossy. You have to be really bossy. I think much like Hadley said, a dramaturg has to be loyal to the text. It is my job to interpret the text. And as a result, I can sometimes take us down a path that is very subjective. It's all what I think. I'm the interpreter of this particular production. And I create what is called a concept. And that means that my designers, my actors, the whole production team tries to create a world that is centered around my conceptual interpretation of the play. Now, this play is pretty controversial in many, many ways, and there have been some seminal productions or films of it that have looked at it from many different angles. Obviously, it's a play, it's a story that takes place during a war. And many of you may have seen the Olivier film, the Laurence Olivier film, that it was filmed, but at the time it was kind of groundbreaking cinema in its own right. It was shot when we were in the throes of the Second World War, and that film views the story of Henry V, Shakespeare's Henry V, from a very pro-war angle. It's very patriotic. It is very let's go fight and get those people. It's very pro-war. Understandably so. Britain was in the throes of a really big deal at the time. There was a seminal production by the Shakespeare Theater production in the 60s that Michael Kahn directed, that was late 60s, early 70s, that was a response to the Vietnam War. And as you can imagine, that particular interpretation was very anti-war. It was very dark, was very, very much like the line of Henry's feet. She never had done this. I looked at it kind of from those angles. So that's how that was interpreted. The Rana film was shot during Margaret Thatcher's time, and the country was embroiled in the Falkland conflict, and that really has sort of a that kind of response, I think. So it's here in my feed, and I'm reading it, and I've had this assignment for about a year, and I've looked at it from a lot of different angles. It is my personal opinion, because I think Shakespeare is very, very clever, that it is neither pro-war nor anti-war. I think it lies somewhere down the middle. I think what this play shows us is the effects of war. What happens to a community, to people, to cities, to infrastructure, to the domestic world during war. At the time Shakespeare wrote this, he was in, the country was deeply embroiled in a very long battle with Ireland. And what was happening in England is were starving. They were, all the money was getting sort of sent to the front, kind of. The soldiers were starving too. But the home front were really having a hard time. And Queen Elizabeth was on the throne at the time, and she wasn't really doing anything about it. And it was heroic Henry is. And yet then in the very next scene, we will see the exact opposite. We'll see Henry do something awful. So I look at that, and on my interpretation of that is that Shakespeare is trying to kind of comment that war is a complicated thing, that it is neither good nor bad, and that in any given soldier, and in any given leader, you can make really good decisions and you can make really poor decisions, and that there is no way that you can do both or one or either all the time. The way he, it's a play of opposites, the way he will set up, for example, this scene at the siege of Harfleur, in which Henry comes out and delivers the most horrific speech about what he's going to do to those French people, particularly the women. The very, very next scene is the French princess talking about body parts, trying to learn the English words for body parts. I think that's no mistake that Shakespeare has put those scenes one right after another. And there are countless examples of that in this play. One of the books that I read when I was prepping for this was The Face of Battle by John Keegan, which is a pretty famous book. It examines three battles, Agincourt, Waterloo, and the Battle of the Somme. And I had bought it just for the Agincourt section, and it was riveting. It reads like a novel. I could not set it down. It is so finely researched and so beautifully articulated that I then read the Waterloo section and then I read the Somme section. And I was talking with my designers, and we were kind of trying to come up with a concept for this play, and my costume designer said, you know, Carolyn, you really keep talking about this book. Maybe what we need to do is sort of figure out how we talk about war globally, as opposed to just this war that took place in the 1400s. And I kind of latched onto that idea. And so what we've done is we've created a very, very theatrical interpretation of this. Like I said before, my chorus comes out and says, "Prim play, folks, make no mistake. We're just awful actors. We have these stupid wooden swords. When you hear, when we talk of horses, imagine that you can see them." And I have supported that essentially with a group of ghost soldiers through time. So my actors in the play are essentially soldiers who are traveling through time telling stories, and they are from all periods. Therefore, when you see this production, you're going to see costumes from Henry's time all the way up through the First World War. And the idea being that war has not really changed that much in all this time, and that the stories of war basically encompass all the same principles, the same ideas. The scenic designer then took that idea, and she has created a set which looks like a scaffold, because the chorus says, "We're on an unworthy scaffold." And on this scaffold are only items of domesticity: rocking horses, baby cradles, a bicycle, a kitchen table. Because that, in my opinion, is who Shakespeare is saying gets the brunt of the war that these leaders take us into.
Okay, Helen has some great pictures to show us. I'm kind of flashing them behind you as you're talking. So
this is a scenic design, which, as you can see, is a scaffold where all of these domestic items live.
As we use them, they come down and we use them, and then they just get left there, so that at the end of the play, we are basically doing the most adorable wooing scene in the midst of complete and utter rubble. The infrastructure has fallen down. The buildings have fallen down. All of the domestic items are strewn all over the stage. And the love match is made between the
people and the friends. This is what it starts to look like. There's a bicycle left there that shares a canal with the girls. And then I kind of showed you, as Karen was talking, a few of the costumes.
So you can see the kind of ghost soldiers that are our storytellers. All different time periods.
they're mostly playing them as women. So you'll see some of the characters have been reinterpreted as female characters. Not always, but a lot. There you go.
Yeah.
So that's sort of
what we have.
But that is what I am doing with it. That is my interpretation.
We'll see if it works.
Yeah.
I don't know if it works.
I know we're not going to see heroes, I hope.
We're not. form in which you don't actually see any fighting. The films, of course, because they can, they can hire 30,000 people and have horses and arrows and whatever, they always put in the fighting. But there is none in the play. I do have a few moments of violence. They're very specifically calculated and do not take place during our time.
Just back to the Globe Theater for a minute. When you say people didn't have anything else to do, so if you're going to a Shakespeare play, would you just kind of wander in and out, go get some grog, and, you know,
you sure would.
Do this? So then it wouldn't necessarily be repetitious in the context of the Globe Theater, is that?
It could be. I mean, I'm sure there were a lot of people who, you know, stayed there the whole time. But yeah, you could walk around. You know, the whole notion of the groundlings who were down in front who stood. The wealthier people sat in boxes, I mean, seats around. It's in the shape of a U for the audience. The way, 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 the peasants and the colored folks stood in a big pit. And you really see that in the play. Benjamin Bonnefoy, who's playing Henry, played Tal last year. It's Tal last year. And you'll see a lot of familiar faces from last year. We were working on the Once More Into the Breach scene the other day. And it's really clear that it's written for the low audience. There are so many references to, oh, you up there, the da 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 da, oh, you down here. I mean, it's clear it's for that specific audience. And then I, of course, have to figure out how to make that work for our American
indoor
modern audience who aren't drinking ale and throwing oranges.
All right, thank you all so much. We're going to do our drawing very quickly.
Round of applause.